bunch of other things are tied in to metabolism, all kinds of disease. So, you know, people with diabetes or obesity, you know, this could be a cell therapy that would help them, you know, restore a healthy, youthful metabolism.
So are these companies, or this company in particular, are they going through FDA trials, or are they offering in the market saying, hey, we already
So have- they do have some stuff. Ajax is getting there. They're working on getting an investigational new drug into the clinic through the FDA. So this is really pretty early stage stuff. It's kind of swing for the fences, moonshot type of stuff.
Right.
But it's the kind of thing where, you know, if you want to have access to some of these revolutionary technologies, have them as part of a long-term strategy, you know, this is the kind of stuff that you want to invest in.
So that's what I say, is that basically you think it's a good idea to have a basket of cell therapy companies at varying stages. You put some, spread some money around there because it's going somewhere.
Yes.
That's interesting. And, you know, I guess the different aspects of that, you have the manufacturing side, you said, you know, who's creating the cells and distributing them. And then I guess you have the clinical application side, you know, who's delivering them to actual patients. Are you a believer in both sides of this from an investment perspective?
Yeah, both sides are going to be valuable. You know, the there's going to be money made on both ends of it. You can't have one without the other. Why have the cells if you don't have anything to use them for?
Right.
And, you know, you can't have the application without the cells. So you need both sides of it, and both of them are important. You know, and I mean, there's other stuff going on. You know, this all involves gene editing as well. And we're seeing some of the first gene therapies hit the market.
So from a biotech standpoint, gene editing is another thing that you think is holding a lot of promise.
You know, earlier this month, we had some very tantalizing early evidence of in vivo gene editing possibly having curative properties in humans. So the company's name is Sangamo Biosciences. And they've got a gene editing platform. Everybody talks about CRISPR, right? Everybody knows about CRISPR. And
incidentally, you know, not everybody, you know, might know CRISPR, but if you're following this stuff, you understand CRISPR.
So it's a platform where you can go in and go into the DNA of a cell and make changes.
Right.
You know, it's basically a code base, a database, right? The DNA molecule holds a bunch of code, and it's a code of life. You know, but some people are born with some garbled data, and they'll have, you know, various inherited diseases that they've either inherited from their parents, they just got an unlucky gene match between mom and dad, or, you know, there was a mutation very early on during their development, and they now have this issue. And most of these, you know, the ones that we can treat, it's lifetime treatment. Some of them involve that you don't produce an adequate enzyme, and you can't break something down in your cells and it builds up. There's many diseases like
this.
You know, others might involve, you know, muscular dystrophy, the dystrophin gene, which is incidentally the largest gene in our cells, is got some bad data in it, and you don't produce the dystrophin protein, and you get muscle wasting over time, and you know, you don't live very long in the more severe forms of muscular dystrophy. But what if you could go in with these folks and put in a working gene or edit the bad gene? You know,
and that's so basically what CRISPR does is gene editing.
Gene editing. Sangamo has a different technology called zinc finger nuclease, but you know, it's it has the advantage you can go in and with great accuracy edit a gene or insert a gene. The recent data that they presented was for a disease called MPS and MPS2, where they don't produce an enzyme needed to break down a glycoprotein. And so this junk builds up in your cells over time, produces really severe effects and greatly shortened lifespan.
So at what point, when you're seeing technologies like this, which are basically, you know, the research, it's getting published, you know, they're trying to move it on a track to get it out, you know, for commercial use, at what point do you think people should be saying it's a good time to invest in it, you know?
There's different ways to invest. I mean, you can invest early and ride it out for a long time, or you can, which is a very viable strategy. Another way to... You could also trade. right? Mm-hmm. Which is not quite the same thing as investing. You know, a company's got a major catalyst coming up. It could be, you know, a real big binary event. It could be clinical data. It could be an FDA decision. And, you know, you can do an analysis of what they've got going on and decide, oh, this is a good one to go long on. Mm-hmm. You know, in 6 months, it could be doing pretty well.
So you're placing a bet before an event.
Yes.
And hoping that it's...
It comes out in your favor. Yeah.
Now, when you do something like that, do you hedge it somehow? Or do you basically just say, okay, I'm pushing these chips onto this bet?
You can.
Yeah, yeah.
And there's you know, strategies to do so. Mm-hmm. Generally, we don't do that in our services. Mm-hmm. Although that's something that we may be considering in the future. There's different option strategies that you can use, mm-hmm. that you can hedge upside and downside and mm-hmm. and things like that, that are a bit more complex. Mm-hmm. They're for more sophisticated people.
So for the people that are reading, you know, your research and information and what you're putting out into the world, who are they typically? Are they, people that just have, some discretionary income and they have an interest in investing in the way that you know, in the areas or the sectors that you talk about? Who's your audience?
My audience is generally people that have worked very hard all their lives. Mm-hmm. They've done all the right things. They've got a little bit, usually, of discretionary income. Mm-hmm. But they want to use that to, you know, they want a little bit more money so they can afford to send their kid to a better school. Mm-hmm. Or they want a little bit more for their own retirement, or they love the game, right?
Right. Yeah.
They want to be involved in this. It's exciting for them, and they enjoy it, which is perfectly understandable for me too. And you know, they just want to keep abreast of what's going on in these areas and be able to act on it in some way and benefit themselves. So you know, those are typically the kind of folks that I write for.
So let me ask maybe the opposite question. Who shouldn't be doing this? Like, you know, who shouldn't be like saying, I'm reading your stuff and I want to put money into this. Like, when is that a bad idea?
Well, I mean, you shouldn't invest your nest egg or anything that you can't afford to lose in some of these ideas because they're pretty speculative.
Yeah.
And they're high risk, which is why they can be high return, mm-hmm. but they are high risk. But if you've got your financial base is set. You got a little mad money that you can play with in these ideas.
Mad money?
Yeah.
I like that, yeah.
Go for it.
Yeah,
right?
yeah. And then, so that's the when it's time.